Hello, you malt. Wait for it. Wait for it. Wait for it. Multimedia types. Yeah. And thank you to Whisky Chops for that malt review. Introducing, as it does, Whisky Review 238 at Ralphie.com. Yippee! I may as well say yippee because I'm about to pour myself some very old, interesting whisky. Mustn't be extravagant, mustn't be greedy, gonna make this last. It's 31 years old, yes, and was distilled in 1979, which was a great decade for the production of Scotch whiskey because basically the distilleries were allowed to get on with it and demand for whiskey was not that high, particularly for single malts. Therefore, the best of casks were looked out by people who genuinely knew what they were doing and set aside for these single malts. And it is today that we're fully appreciating and some of us paying quite a lot of money. Not me personally, I'm kind of canny with my money, but there's people paying an awful lot of money to drink some of these old whiskies from the 1970s. This is 1979, it's cask number 1546 and it's Glenglassaugh single malt. 31 years old, it comes out at 44.7% alcohol after all that time, which further confirms that the myth that alcohol evaporates at 2% volume per year from casks while in maturation is codswallop. Now, what do we have here? We have a fragile, characterful old whiskey. It was matured in a hogshead, most certainly after 31 years, not a fresh or first fill hogshead. This is quite possibly third fill hogshead. It certainly seems as if it's been left alone in some dunnage warehouse and not been punted about through these big industrial units that distillers are using so frequently these days. But these dunnage actually comes through in the smell, that wonderful slightly damp mustiness which complements the spirit in the whiskey and the cask influence in the whiskey, so that it actually provides almost a third component. Some may accuse me of speculating and being a bit luddite, and do you know what, malt mates? Do I have my caring face on? No, I don't care. I believe that dunnage maturation benefits the end result of a whiskey, and it certainly is evident in this case. Tasting notes. I'll go through my tasting notes now, and then I'm going to tell you not just a little bit more about Glenglassaugh, quite a lot more about Glenglassaugh, because it is a very interesting distillery with a checkered history that is coming into perhaps its renaissance. That's just an opinion. Nose of a 31-year-old whiskey. Colour? Ignore the colour. It tells you very, very little. Doesn't really matter, actually. First thing you notice is it's old cask. It's got that leathery, slightly camphorish wood camphor, furniture polish, musty, slightly mouldy. Yeah, no, I mean mouldy in a nice sense. Nice mould, as in tasty blue cheese type mould, but pertaining to the maturation in a dunnage warehouse. Right. I'm going to move on quickly now before I start tying myself up in knots here. Delicate sherry, wonderful sherry that's not imposing itself like a forearm smash here in the WWF. Nah. I know there's a big fashion for heavily sherried whiskies, but I do recommend that you do not overlook the lightly sherried whiskies, because they do have their own character. And in fact, you can often find that the spirit itself has better composure in a light cask influence rather than a heavy cask influence, as we have here. The fruitiness, which is part of the character of Glenglassaugh, is so completely intact after 31 years. I'm just completely delighted with it. Lots of fresh fruit, not stewed fruit, but a touch of raisins, sure. Hence the sultanas, sure. But we're talking apples, Cox's apples, beautifully sweet, russety dessert apples, not as dessert, eating apples, with pear, conference pear, and a certain plummy note as well, fresh plums, beautiful greengage as well, gooseberries in there. We're talking about a fruit basket out of some English orchard and market garden, that sort of fruitiness. There's rose hip, there's some honeyed citrus, soft, slightly orangey lemon citrus just floating about in amongst the fresh fruit here. And as I've mentioned earlier, leather and polish, those classic components of old casks. Taste-wise, clean, complex, intrinsically complex arrival, with the fruit and the cask influence and that maltiness and that grassy hay character all together in a one-er. It's sweet, there's a sweet sherry there, but the sweet sherry is balanced off by the tannins in the oak cask that have been slowly imparting themselves into the spirit over all these years. And lemongrass, more fresh fruit, and maple, soft maple syrup. There is a soft complexity and a touch of water. And with old whiskies, just as a reminder, guys, with old whiskies, try it first without water. And when you do add water, particularly old sherried whiskies, one, maybe two drops, that's really all you need. And you will be stunned at the difference it makes even over 5 to 10 minutes. Old whiskies need more time to reveal themselves and open up compared to young whiskies. You're paying more for old whiskies. That means one thing. Enjoy them, savour them, smell them, drink them even slower and over a longer period compared to what you normally would. And you will be rewarded for that. You'll be rewarded by the subtleties and the evolution of the smell. Even now, there's a kind of soft honey's kind of growing. There's a sweetness coming through having added that drop of water, and it will continue to develop. I know, because for the 2 hours that I had this glass of whiskey in my hand last night, when I was writing my tasting notes up, I thought this is the bee's knees, as we say in Scotland, bee's knees. Additional notes. It's not so much the flavour complexity which is interesting about this whiskey. It's just the unique experience you get from tasting an old whiskey, which isn't 5-star. But it's either a very good 3.5-star, potentially a 4-star. This does not have a big finish by a long chalk. The finish, by the way, is actually quite balsamic. And furthermore, once you've added a few drops of water, you will notice over about 15 minutes later, you will notice that there's a kind of bitter oak starts to materialise. It doesn't flood out or drown out the other flavours, but it removes the balance that's been existing there, that's already been there. Drinking and enjoying old whiskies is a skill. I have this theory that it's probably best appreciated by those who can least afford them, because they're most likely to value them from the start. This is a whiskey that you would treat yourself to if you're in a member of a whisky club. And remember, you only need 6 to 8 people, 10 people, maybe 12 people in a little whisky club. You all put your money in the kitty, and 2-3 times a year you buy an old bottle of whisky, and then you've basically got good company on a good whisky night out. You can share it, talk about it, start with a younger whisky, and really get the most of what these old ones have to offer. Glenglassaugh offers quite a lot as a single malt. Here we are, a mark. It's a malt mark. It's 90 out of 100. Smashing. Wonderful. I'll pop this out of the way now. Around a bit. I bought this independent bottling of Glenglassaugh because the official bottlings, the 30 and the 40 years old, are well beyond my budget. Glenglassaugh as a distillery is located in northeast Scotland near a place called Portsoy, which is very old and very attractive, particularly down at the harbour. Fascinating harbour walls. And it's a very agricultural part of the East Highlands. The distillery itself actually lies just outside of the Speyside region of distilleries. It's that little bit further east, and it's also a remarkably coastal distillery. It's not coastal like Ardbeg and Lagavulin, sitting literally on the rocks beside the sea. This distillery is a field away. It's just a little bit detached, but you cannot miss out on the fact that this is a coastal distillery. It's also a delicate whisky, substantial but delicate. The character of Glenglassaugh is big fruit, fresh fruit, with touches of toffee and tea, and a certain kind of citrusy note to it as well. Lovely wee citrusy part to the fruitiness, the full fruitiness. And it's a distillery you won't see much of because it's been shut down, or mothballed as they call, for as much time as it's been actually producing whiskey. It used to be a great favourite with the blenders, but it closed down in 1986 when it was mothballed for the last time and was basically falling into ruin until it was taken over by a consortium of private investors who were looking at the long-term investment for the manufacture of, wait for it, craft quality single malt, made the traditional way. That's important. You know me, you know that I really like it when a distillery in Scotland or anywhere does things which involve people doing real jobs, not the computers, people twiddling levers and all the rest of it, because you get something into the spirit. And that thing is the fact that people who care about their job will want to do the best of what they can with their experience and commitment in what they're producing. When computers are in control, computers are manipulated and adjusted by people in offices who have maybe last seen a still a year back when they had a wee quick visit to a distillery. The problem with computers is it disconnects the control from a distillery to a central office. It takes control away from people who are hands-on, know what they're doing, and passes it to people who do not have that hands-on approach. Moving on, controversial area. I know it is. It will become even more controversial in a few years' time when we start to see the divergence between quality whiskies like Glenglassaugh, Kilhoman, Bladnach, Bruichladdy, Springbank, from the big deluxe blended branded whiskies, which more and more, due to the necessities of being a big business, have to basically have a standardization of operation. That's what it is. We live in the age where the labels on many items that we can buy are more important than the contents behind the labels. That's a fact. With small craft distilleries, they know that their survival depends on the intrinsic quality of what they produce. And never, never in the history of the whisky industry in Scotland or the world has that ever been more recognised, acknowledged and important as it is right now, here in 2011. Interesting times, malt mates. Interesting times. Glenglassaugh, incidentally, have been running for about 3 odd years. They have reopened, are continuing to refurbish. The next two vlogs after this one, vlog number 238 part B and 238 part C, are actually recorded at the distillery in a recent visit I made, and will give you an insight as to what they're all about. There you go. Spoilers! Anyway, I'm going to conclude now by saying there's many occasions where you can't taste the official distillery product when it's not available. Your only option is to go through the independent bottlers. Thank goodness they're there. But I look forward to sharing a fresh young Glenglassaugh single malt, new hot off the hot out the warehouses, with you before too long, when I can get round to buying a bottle. Lovely. Ah, splendid stuff. It's continuing to open up, although I noticed that little bit of oak bitters coming in here. But an excellent whisky. Lovely stuff, lovely stuff. I'll just round off and conclude by saying that it's something which I have appreciated in my recent visit to Glenglassaugh, with the amount of access that they afforded me. And I would wish Stuart Nickerson and all his team of busy workers up at Glenglassaugh Distillery all the best for the future. And guys, Ralphie opinion here, you're doing a great job. Keep up the good work, because it really is appreciated. And I want the whole world to know that. There we have it. Thank you for watching. I'm Ralphie at ralphie.com. Whisky reviews, whisky stuff, whisky whatevers. Thank you for watching. And I'll be back soon with some on-location vlogs at Glenglassaugh. Yippee.